Earlier this week, the leader of the Labour Party, Jeremy Corbyn, was in the studio. Yesterday, it was the Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, on the sofa as part of the election campaign.
Today, it's the turn of Scottish National Party leader, Nicola Sturgeon, as we talk to those who could get the keys to number 10 or hold the balance of power. So it's only a few days away now.
Yes, thankfully.
How has the campaign trail been for you so far?
It's been good fun. It's been pretty intense. Quite exhausting, as I think most leaders would tell you, but it's always quite good when the end point comes in sight and you know it's just a few days to go. But I'm feeling very optimistic about it.
And what is it people are talking to you about most? Is it Brexit?
Breakfast right now, yeah.
Is it Brexit? Is it Scottish referendum? National Health Service?
A bit of all of these things. Obviously, Brexit is quite high up in people's minds. And in Scotland, because we didn't vote for Brexit, that ties in very much with Scottish independence sometimes, because we're thinking about how we try to get into a situation where we're not taken out of Europe against our will. But of course, people care deeply about the health service, education. These things are the responsibility of the Scottish Parliament, so they're not directly affected by this election, although, of course, the budgets that we have to spend are determined still by Westminster, so it has a big impact.
But how can you say about being taken out of Europe against your will? What would you say to fellow Scots who would say they're as equally patriotic as you?
Yeah.
And you talk about you're horrified at being ripped out of Europe. Mm. The way you describe Boris Johnson ripping Scotland out of Europe, but a lot those people would see, they would be horrified at being ripped out of the Union.
Well, that would only happen if a majority of people voted for that. The position Scotland's in with Brexit is different, I accept, to the position across the UK as a whole, because in Scotland, more than 60% of people voted to remain in the EU. So it's not a majority view that we should leave the European Union. When we had the independence referendum 5 years ago, albeit narrowly, people voted against independence and were not independent yet because of that. So independence for Scotland will only happen if a majority of people in Scotland vote for it.
Why do you want them to vote for it? Obviously, it's very important. Why is it so important?
Well, I should say, I'm sitting here in a studio in London, Scotland will always be the best of friends, the closest of allies to the other countries of the UK. Lots of us, myself included, have family in England. Those ties are never going to be broken. But if Scotland is independent, a bit like Ireland is already, we have that relationship on the basis of equality. So we can't be in a position where, because England, which is, you know, much bigger than Scotland, votes one way, we just have to be dragged along in the wake of that. We can take our own decisions, decide what direction we want the country to take.
The hurt, I think, for a lot of people is, you say Westminster should have no control in running Scotland, yet you'd be happy for Brussels to run Scotland.
Well, no, I wouldn't be happy for Brussels to run Scotland, but that argument on the face of it, I think, is, you know, quite a reasonable one. But when you sort of get under the surface of that, it quickly becomes less so. Every single member country of the European Union is an independent country. You know, France and Germany, Spain and Portugal. The fact that they're in the European Union doesn't take away their independence. They just come together to collaborate and cooperate on the issues that countries have to collaborate on. Climate change, of course, one of the biggest issues we face today. And Scotland would do that with England, Wales, Northern Ireland as well.
How can you say climate change is one of the biggest issues when, like, your economy runs on oil?
We're in the transition away from fossil fuels and we need to accelerate that transition. But 75% of Scotland's electricity comes from renewable energy already. We're actually ahead of most of the rest of the world in this transition to a net zero economy. And like all countries, we have to speed that process up.
Yeah. First Minister, I think there's a lot of sensitivities that people in the rest of the UK, well, certainly maybe in England and Wales, don't totally appreciate. And one of those is the word backstop. And backstop applied to the Northern Irish situation. If backstop comes about, it looks, thankfully, economically, if not politically, because there are political implications, that Northern Ireland could be the place to invest. If you would have access to the European markets, you could have access to the UK markets without tariffs. And if you were a British company, if you were a European company, Northern Ireland looks a very good place to be. Yep. Now, whilst that is fantastic news for my home country, not so good for Scotland. Yeah. Could you explain why?
Well, I should say, first of all, I don't grudge Northern Ireland any of that. And I think it's really important in this whole Brexit process that peace in Ireland is not compromised and it has been treated
with a lot of neglect. Which is the other side of the coin.
Absolutely. Yeah. But Yes, as the First Minister of Scotland, obviously I'm interested in investment into Scotland. When I talk, as I do regularly, to companies that might be thinking of investing in Scotland or looking to expand in Scotland, often there are competitor cities to Glasgow and Edinburgh, and sometimes that will be Belfast. And if in the future we have a situation where Northern Ireland is still effectively in the European single market and the customs union, then it's going to be much harder, not just for Scotland, but for a lot of cities in England and Wales to compete on that basis. And that risks putting us at a competitive disadvantage.
So what I'm getting at is I think a lot of people may be watching today and saying, there's your woman on again. What's she going on about independence?
Probably.
You're one policy party. It's nothing to do with us. I live in Yorkshire, or I live in Cambridgeshire, or I live in Devon, or whatever it happens to be. And they're thinking, how do you affect them? But you are relevant to them, are you not?
Well, in all sorts of ways. I mean, the SNP is anything but a one policy party. I mean, if you look at Labour's manifesto just now, a lot of the policies that they're putting forward, free prescriptions, free personal care for older people, taking away university tuition fees, the SNP government in Scotland has already done all of these things.
But a lot of people have asked how you pay for that. I mean, are you paying for that at the detriment of other things, the National Health Service, for example?
No, we invest more per person in Scotland in the National Health Service than is the case in England. So per person in Scotland, health spending is about...
But there have been a lot
about...
of complaints that you haven't delivered all your promises.
Health services in Scotland, England, Wales, Northern Ireland, across most of the world are facing big pressures just now because demand's rising, people are living longer, which is a good thing. But we're investing more. We've got a record number of people working in our health service. There are challenges around waiting times, but more people are being treated within those waiting times now than was the case a year or so ago.
But there won't be
so
people who really say that surely that treating people in the NHS is more important than paying tuition fees.
Or having IndyRef too.
Well, you know, independence in a sense is because our public services have suffered, as have public services in England, from a decade of austerity that a Conservative government has imposed upon us. And one of the advantages of being independent is we make our own decisions around that. On your point about health versus tuition fees, I think we should try to do all of these things. I grew up in a working class community. I got to go to university. Back then, I don't know whether I would have got to go to university if I'd had to pay tuition fees. And having had the benefit, which I benefit from hugely, of a free university education, I don't think I've got the right to take that away from the next generation of young people coming up behind me.
OK, but really if you vote SNP, there you are in Scotland, bitter rivals with the Labour Party in Scotland. You want to annihilate them.
Some would say we've already done that,
have.
But I'm not being complacent ahead of an election.
But yet, you could, maybe you would, cosy up to Jeremy Corbyn.
I wouldn't use the term cosy up.
OK. You could form an alliance
but
with them.
You say you want to lock Boris
out.
The only way you can do that, surely, is to form an alliance.
I guess just to go back to the independence point, one of the reasons I want Scotland to be independent is because I don't want Scotland to always have to be choosing between the devil and the deep blue sea when it comes to who is Prime Minister. Conservative governments for my whole lifetime have done real damage to Scotland and to other parts of the UK, real damage to the kind of communities that I grew up in. I think Brexit is a disaster. I think Boris Johnson's a disaster, if I can be undiplomatic and blunt about it in a Scottish characteristic, Scottish style. And so I could never support Boris Johnson as Prime Minister. I'm not a huge fan of Jeremy Corbyn, but if the SNP holds the balance of power in a hung parliament...
But is it the man you're not fond of, or his policy,
well,
or his party?
I don't agree with all of his policies. Some of his policies are policies my government's already introduced. I'm not a great fan of his, I was going to say leadership style, I would say probably lack of leadership, particularly over Brexit. But if we hold the balance of power, which I think is a situation that gives Scotland enormous influence, then we have to make a choice. And if I can't support Boris Johnson, then we would look to support a sort of progressive alliance.
What would your conditions be to support the Labour Party?
The end of austerity, the end to the punishing welfare cuts, making sure that there is a respect for Scotland's right to choose our own future. And I know a lot of people worry about the prospect of Jeremy Corbyn as Prime Minister, people in Scotland, including elsewhere. And what I would say is, well, if he gets himself into a position where he is a potential Prime Minister, isn't it maybe better to have the influence of the SNP, with all of our experience in government in Scotland, in there trying to exert that influence than Jeremy Corbyn?
Well, people have to make up their
mind
in that. But what you're saying is vote SNP, get Labour.
No, I'm saying vote SNP and get SNP in Scotland, people who stand up for
Scotland. But in the rest of the country, you would prop up a Corbyn government.
If that's only going to happen if he manages to get enough support in England to make the arithmetic of that possible. And it puts Scotland into a more influential position. First of all, people have got to vote to get Boris Johnson out, and all of the Tory seats in Scotland,
okay,
the SNP's the challenger.
IndyRef 2. I mean, your mandate for IndyRef 2 rests on Scotland being pulled out of the EU against its will. So if Jeremy Corbyn got in, if Brexit was cancelled, then surely that means you've lost that mandate, doesn't it?
The point I'm putting forward in this election, and it's up to people to decide how they vote next Thursday, is that the whole experience of the past 3.5 years, Brexit is a very acute and extreme example of the position Scotland is in, of, you know, not being treated with an awful lot of respect, our voice not being listened to, facing a future that we haven't chosen. And I think that experience means that it's right for Scotland to decide, is it happy with that, or does it want to choose something different? And that's the proposition I'm putting to people in Scotland. Let's make sure whatever our future as a country is going to be, it's one we've decided ourselves rather than having
it imposed by Boris. If Boris Johnson gets in, though, he decides. And you'd have to go cap in hand to him, and you'll say, listen, Bojo, will you give me another referendum?
I might not be as polite as that. I mean,
and he'll say, no, not on your Nelly. And so what's plan B?
I love that phrase, not on your Nelly. if we end up in that scenario, I'll cross that bridge, and if you invite me back, I'll come and talk about it. But we've got, 6 days now to go to an election, and I'd rather focus for those 6 days on saying to Scotland, look, we can stop that situation arising, because we can vote in a way that helps to mean that Boris Johnson doesn't get his majority, and come a week today, we're not waking up to the prospect of him being Prime Minister. He's not calling the shots over Scotland's future.
Just a final point, First Minister. You are the leader of the SNP. Mm. The CEO of the SNP is a man called Peter Murrell. Now, a lot of people may not know he's actually your husband. So do you work with your husband? I mean, I only speak out of interest to someone who loves working with their married partner.
I am in awe at how you manage to work in such close proximity. Peter and I, Peter's the chief executive of the SNP, but we don't physically work together, so we work in different spaces. I think.
What about you discuss politics at home?
Obviously, it's inevitable sometimes, given the nature of my job in particular, that it crops up where I'm taking phone calls all the time and dealing with things. But where we have a choice in it, we try not to. We try to kind of steer clear of it as much as possible. But if I had to sit on a sofa with them at work every day,
Don't do it.
Well, happy Christmas to you.
I've got you a present.
What's this?
It's a decoration for one of your many Christmas trees. Santa in a kilt.
Santa in a kilt.
There you go.
That's
This is very me. I love. Yes. Which of our many trees?
Yeah. Which one? That one.
Well, anyway, we'll find a tree. But I have to say, I love a bit of a decoration. I do. I really do.
That's Scottish Parliament tartan.
Lovely. It's lovely.
Nicola Sturgeon. Thank you.
Thank you both very much.
Do you know what my Scottish kilt is? What? McTavish.
Lovely.
I don't know
what color is that?
Holmes comes from Hume in Scotland, which is part of the McTavish clan.
Well, there you go.
There you go.
I've learned something new about you today.
Very good.
And happy birthday.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.